It is truly a pleasure to have David Greene with us tonight to discuss his new book, Midnight in Siberia, A Train Journey into the Heart of Russia. I just have to say, it's always fun, and I don't know if you have this experience, but I always find it great fun to put an NPR voice with a face, not to mention a book. I think that most of you, if you listen to NPR, are very familiar with David's voice. He's covered the Bush White House for many years. He covered the 2008 presidential election. He served as Moscow correspondent before taking up his current position as co-host of Morning Edition. And then we're even doubly lucky, and tonight is really what I would call a twofer, an NPR twofer, because we actually get to put two NPR voices and faces together. David will be in conversation tonight with Mahulika Sika, who's a executive editor of NPR News, herself an author of a book called The Breast Cancer Alphabet. We just happened to feature it in our weekly newsletter and blog. It's on display right over here for Breast Cancer Awareness Month this month. And I just want to say that, Mahulika, we were happy to have you for an event for your book as well earlier this year. So welcome to both of you. Now about David's book, Midnight in Siberia. It is, as the subtitle suggests, about David's, I think it was 5,500 miles or close to that, trip on the Trans-Siberian Railway from Moscow to Vladivostok with quite a few stops in between. He is a wonderful storyteller, insightful and funny, and the adventures he recounts certainly make for some very entertaining reading. But I think what is most special about this book is that it gives us a deeper sense of the broad landscape of 21st century Russia, the Russia of Putin and, okay, I hope I say this right, babushkas, right?
Perfect.
Babushkas, not babushkas, which is something different. Babushkas, and vodka, and Ukraine, and oligarchs, and poets, and ballet, and hockey, and guys named Sergei and Boris, and more vodka, and many more things that turn out to be emblematic of this huge, confounding, and in David's words, unwieldy, maddening, addictive country. Throughout his reporting career, David has become a master of letting his subjects speak for themselves, thus presenting a more authentic story about the world they inhabit. Midnight in Siberia is a great example of how, by understanding people, we can better understand history events as they unfold around us. It is truly a terrific book. It's also his first book, and I was saying to him earlier, congratulations not only on writing your first book, but writing your first book that's terrific. That's amazing and wonderful. I just want to also note before I close that there are some tremendous photos in this book. They're all black and white, which just provides a really wonderful accent to the remarkable stories that come to life in the pages of Midnight in Siberia. So welcome, David. Welcome, Mahulika. Thank you so much for being here. Please join me in welcoming.
Thanks, Lissa. Okay, does this work? Because it would be really embarrassing if we didn't get the mic right because we're from NPR. Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much for having us.
Lissa,
we really appreciate it.
To our neighborhood bookstore, of which I am a member. I hope you all are. We are from public radio. We know something about membership. So in addition to your membership to Politics and Prose, there might be some other membership you might want to consider. So here we are. And David's going to talk about his book, or I'm going to ask him hard-hitting questions about his book. But I actually want to start with David telling us, reading from the book, a little bit about the Trans-Siberian Railway, because he rode the rails. He didn't ride one train that you got on in Moscow and ended up in Vladivostok. It wasn't like the Orient Express or something like that. He rode the rails the way Russian people ride the rails, not rich people who want to get from one place to the other and live in a lap of luxury. And I think that that's really what makes this book so distinct, that you really get a feel for the way people ride the rails, why the rails so important to them, and the range of people and places across this mammoth country. So David's going to read two short excerpts that tell us a little about the railway.
Chosen by my former boss, Mahulika Sika. thank you. You'll have to bear with me. I have to say, I'm a sweater, and I had a day for a guy with a face for radio. I was just on television on PBS, and I have makeup now that is literally falling down my face. So I will, if you see me doing that, don't complain. I am not used to makeup. I never want makeup. If anyone at NPR is worried that I ever want to go into television, look at this. This is the reason why you never have to worry.
Those
I love
you,
radio.
Many of you have seen broadcast news, right?
Yeah, that's me. Okay, so this is what you want me to read. The Trans-Siberian Railway is intertwined in Russian history. After years of struggle, mismanagement, and vicious battles with the land and elements, the railroad, at first from St. Petersburg to Vladivostok, was completed in 1916 and quickly became a symbol of Russian ingenuity. Russians marveled at how they were able to build a 6,000-mile-long railroad that held the vast country together and opened up the Asian frontier. The railroad crossed forbidden landscapes and required complicated bridges, one of which shared a prize with the Eiffel Tower for world-class design. Today, Trans-Siberian is a catchword for a number of routes. If you travel from St. Petersburg or Moscow to Vladivostok or from Moscow to Beijing, you're definitely on a Trans-Siberian journey. But long trips between cities that are far apart and that take you a good distance from west to east or east to west can also safely be called Trans-Siberian. There's a haunting past. The rails were constructed largely by migrant workers and prison laborers, many of whom, in the words of American Paul Richardson, who writes about Russian culture, died, quote, from exposure and from infectious disease, from typhoid to the bubonic plague. The railroad once built was also convenient for Joseph Stalin, who used it to transport exiles to Siberia. By the hundreds of thousands, the Kremlin could send government critics, lawyers, doctors, religious leaders, really anyone it chose, to the dreaded gulags in some of the harshest conditions on Earth. Stanley Kowalski was a gulag survivor. His daughter described the tortures of the train her father experienced in her 2009 book, No Place to Call Home. The Polish army officer was captured by the Soviets in 1939 and transported by train between prisons several times. One journey took him across nearly all of Russia on the Trans-Siberian in a red boxcar with little light. And here's the description. The train made unscheduled stops in deserted stations or empty fields where, if lucky, prisoners might be allotted their daily ration of food, a piece of bread and fish. Water, on the other hand, was becoming a rare commodity. At some stations, the inmates would pound upon the barred doors, demanding something to quench their thirst, but often their pleading was to no avail. Amidst these surroundings, the weak had little chance of survival. Okay, where am I going from here?
Page 49.
All right.
It's complicated.
It's complicated to consider the Trans-Siberian's impact on Russia's economy. In the early days, critics saw building the railroad as wasteful, but closer to completion, others thought pouring money into the project was driving economic growth. What's more, it made it easier for the Soviet government to transport people and resources and industrialize Siberia. But that may now be part of Russia's problem. In their 2003 book, The Siberian Curse, scholars Fiona Hill and Clifford Gaddy describe how many remote cities are all but cut off. They have no railways or major highways linking them to the rest of the country, while airline tickets remain prohibitively expensive. Riding the Trans-Siberian, you meet passengers who need to reach isolated places for work or to see family or friends, and the Trans-Siberian is their only option. They might get off the train in a large city, then drive hundreds of miles to reach their destination. But the question Hill and Gaddy ask, should so many people be living in these places? They argue that the Soviet government, by relocating people and industries to some of the coldest, harshest, and most remote places on the planet, made monumental errors that now explain many of Russia's economic struggles. In a way, traveling the railway can feel as if you're riding down Russia's spine, seeing the link that connects so many disparate places. Deeper considerations notwithstanding, today a Trans-Siberian train adventure is a dream destination for travelers all over the world, mentioned in the same breath as the Orient Express and the Queen Elizabeth II.
Thank you.
There you have it.
Well, you weren't riding on the Orient Express
No.
or on the QE2. The reason I wanted to start with that description was I really think it so evocatively paints a picture of the importance of the railroad through the history of Russia, Soviet Union, and now Russia again. And just beautiful descriptions of the starkness and the emptiness of it. But I want you to start with telling us about Moscow, because that's where we sent you. You were our Moscow bureau chief.
I was.
And Moscow is not like that at all.
No, Moscow is, and I should say my wife has come in right back there. You can wave. You were introduced earlier. It's in absence. So Rose and I moved to Moscow in 2009 when NPR made me the Moscow bureau chief, and it is a vibrant city. It's an exciting city. It's an infuriating city. It is a place where something is always happening. Life on the streets can be maddening because there's a coldness to people that says something about Russia. I mean, a lot of Russians on the outside are sort of cold and unwelcoming. It's why when Russians come to the United States, they ask why Americans smile so damn much. And so you are in this world where people are rushing to get where they're going, and no one seems to be thinking about these other humans that are sharing the streets and subways with them. But it's also a place where when you find an escape, like a little cafe or restaurant or basement place to, you know, have a night of drinking vodka or tea and sharing it with friends, the payoff is so much more because you've escaped this crazy exterior on the outside and you found sort of a hidden world on the inside. And Rose and I would often say that when you would find those spaces, they would make for such memorable evenings. But I think the important thing to know about Moscow is it's not Russia. Mm-hmm. And Madalika, you played a big role in me learning that, because when we did the first railroad trip, which was for a radio series on Morning Edition, it was when the anti-Putin protests were erupting in Moscow at the end of 2011. And there were some who thought that, why isn't our Moscow correspondent in Moscow when this is happening? And, you know, we had made a big commitment to do this train trip. And I remember being out there in the middle of Siberia, hearing that Madalika agreed with me that being out there in the wilds of Russia was exactly the place to be at sort of an inflection point when there are a lot of questions about the future of this country. And, you know, in Moscow when those protests were happening, it takes a lot of courage to go out and protest in Russia. I mean, this is a place where the president once said, if you are protesting without permission, you should be clubbed in the head. So to take nothing away from people who decide to go on the streets and let their voices be heard. But those were also, that was just a sliver of the story of this country. And to understand that and to be out on the train and realize that Moscow, for everything it is, doesn't tell the story of this country was really something important to learn about.
And I think you learn that very quickly in the book, almost as soon as you leave Moscow. Can you start by telling us a little bit about the system of getting your train ticket and getting on the train?
The system of getting a train ticket is a little different from Amtrak.
They don't have an app?
They don't have an app. Maybe they
okay,
do now.
Amtrak
maybe it's come.
So well.
Nothing makes sense in Russia. And that's sort of something you have to accept. You go through a day, and actually my dear friend Chandler Arnold said it best. He's sitting in the fourth row here. He came to visit me. He said, Russia giveth and taketh away so quickly, all in the same hour, all in the same minute. You know, something great will happen, something horrible will happen. I remember just trying to get on a bus to go to the U.S. Embassy at one point, and I'm standing there outside with my rubles waiting to board. And I'm getting on, and the driver just looked at me with this sort of mean face and could tell that I was an American, didn't know much Russian, and he wouldn't let me buy the ticket. I was trying to hand him the change, and he just wouldn't do it. And he starts driving, won't let me through the turnstile, so I'm sort of stuck there with him, and we're hanging out and not exactly talking, and this is uncomfortable because he's making my life miserable. And we get to the next stop, and he's basically opening the door and expecting me to get out. And I was almost in tears. And then all of a sudden, I hear this woman yell from the back of the bus, basically, "Hey, kid," in Russian. And I look back, and there she is wading through the crowd of people on the bus with her card, her bus card, her fare card. And she wades through, fights through, hands it to me, gives the driver this dirty look and says something in Russian that I probably shouldn't interpret even if I knew what it was. And I look at the other passengers, and they all had their cards out. They were all reaching for their fare cards, having seen this happen. It was this beautiful moment. And so navigating this place to get to the moments when Russia is giving and not taking is really critical. And so buying train tickets can be frustrating, frustrating, frustrating. Often you will go to a train station. There'll be schedules that you can't decipher, and it's not because you don't know the language. Even Russians can't really decipher the schedules. And you will walk up there, and there'll be a glass window with one of the ticket agents. And normally, it's so thick that you can't actually hear what they're saying. And they have a speaker that doesn't exactly work, And so you literally sit there and you're like, you know, hi, can I have a train ticket? Like, okay, yes, to Yaroslavl. The first time I did this, Sergey, my colleague, our NPR's Moscow producer, and who took both of these trips with me, is standing there trying to, he's trying to interpret what is uninterpretable. You know, she's like, I think she just said, do you want a pillow? Yeah, I think a pillow would be good. Okay. I mean, it just goes on like that. But it's so Russian. You sort of get used to life like that, and you just hope and expect and pray for, you know, things to take a turn for the better.
I think what's really clear is that everything is an ordeal.
Good way to put it.
Just from the very basic things to really big things, but there's nothing simple or straightforward about anything, let alone taking a 6,000-mile train trip.
And to get to that understanding and realize it's not just the language is a wonderful place. I remember Rose and I were sitting one night. We suddenly had this just epiphany. We're like, you know what? I think everyone else is really confused too. It's not just us because we're just learning Cyrillic. It's like everyone lives like this. Yeah, this is great.
So you get on the train.
Uh-huh.
There are berths.
There are.
There's a hierarchy.
There is.
You went like third class?
We
second class first and then third. You saved third class for Rose.
Saved third class for Rose. Yeah, I thought you'd really enjoy that experience. Yeah, the first train trip I did, we did mostly second class, which has these cabins that have four beds in them. Very intimate. I mean, if there are only two of you, you're sharing this small space with two strangers, which can be wonderful. And I mean that in a positive way and a negative way, depending on the people. But Sergey and I decided to go mostly third class on this last trip. And third class, if you imagine sort of a large, narrow college dormitory with like 50 bunks. And if you imagine all of those bunks filled, you sort of share a lot with people. sounds and smells and experiences. And I mean, you're all together. I mean, there was one night when there was just orchestral snoring that kept me up all night long, and somehow I looked around and everyone else was sleeping through, and I was like, what is wrong with me? I mean, this is who can sleep through this? But there's also, you kind of, I don't know, I think a lot of Russians, probably going back through Soviet times, were used to more intimate spaces and communal living, and they seem to sort of just adjust to this very naturally. And when you're an outsider, you have to learn some of the routines. I mean, if Madalika were on the bottom bunk and I were above her and we didn't know each other, to actually get to the top bunk, I would all but have to step on her face to sort of climb up there, or figure out a way to use my elbows and, you know, kind of lift myself up
That's
above you.
That's why they're so good at gymnastics.
That's why they're so good at gymnastics. This all makes sense now. Yeah, and Sergey would just do it with ease, and I would expect that he wanted, you know, me to put up a 9.7 when he got up and was successfully in his bunk, and I would be sort of hanging there, and you look down the aisle and you see that there are 40 other people who are kind of watching and really amused. But yeah, Rose joined me for about a week on this trip, and I had not warned her that we were going third class, and we were in Novosibirsk, and we were boarding the train. Around 11 o'clock at night, we're walking up the platform, and she's sort of looking in the windows of the cars that we were approaching, and she's like, so where are our cars? And I said, oh, that's us. And we boarded, and, you know, the trains that Sergey and I had been on had families, and, you know, really, you know, they were just welcoming. There were a lot of men, a lot of women, a lot of kids. We happened to get on this train when Rose was with me, and it was 99% young men who were traveling the rails to look for construction jobs. And so Rose and I got on, and she immediately sat down and started recording a video on her iPhone as we were sitting on our berth. And it was a video to our future children. And it said, hi, it's your mom. The fact that you're watching this means that the marriage between your father and I survived what's going on behind us right now. Do you see what he's done to me? And there we were, just with all these guys who were kind of, you know, getting ready for bed and taking interest in my wife. It was good.
So you encounter a lot of people on the rails who are taking mammothly long trips to get to see family or friends or and they do it not very regularly, but it's a thing.
Yeah.
And there's a ritual and a protocol. There are two things that I thought were particularly interesting about sort of rituals you noticed. One was about the food. And for those of us who know David, that any assignment we send him on, food is a very important part of how he tells the story.
Not a lot of it, just sampling different types of it. It's not like I'm gorging on that.
And how people sort of, you know, the friends or relatives who you're visiting, they take you to the train station, they get you on the train. There's a lot of waving and ritual and hugs and everything else. And something that David and I share is our love for the movie Love Actually. And reading about this in the book reminded me of the airport scene in Love Actually.
Yeah.
So just tell us about the food, because I think the dining car wasn't exactly what you had hoped.
No.
But that doesn't stop people. And you get to see a different side of Russian, something you weren't expecting. And this was about food sharing.
Yeah. How many of you have been to Russia? Have you? Okay, so you've gone to restaurants and you understand that menus are different. I mean, when you go to a menu...
Aspirational.
They're aspirational. Menu here, you actually think that you could order something on it and it would show up and you could eat it. In Russia, often it's sort of... It's aspirational. It's like, God, here are a bunch of things that we think we could cook at some point if we had the ingredients. And then the server tells you what they have. Well, it's that times 10 on a Trans-Siberian... dining car. You look at this thick menu and you're sort of like, well, how do they have all the ingredients to make all this stuff? And then you realize they don't. On one train, I mean, literally they just had borscht and vodka, which, you know, was fine. The borscht was delicious. But you realize in part it's probably because they don't always do a great business, because a lot of Trans-Siberian rail passengers will bring their own food from home, or maybe their family prepared it for them when they were leaving. And there's this just wonderful ritual of food sharing. And when you go into someone's, you know, space or cabin, you know, it's sort of that they're going to offer you something. And the first time I did this, I did not totally understand this ritual, nor did I prepare for it. I walked in and this wonderful woman who was coming from being with her family in Belarus, she had this link of Belarusian sausage, and she used it to wave me into her car, and I sat down, and she brought out bread and this horseradish concoction that was delicious, I think. And all I had to give her was a Luna bar that I had brought with me from the U.S. It was the first stop, and she politely declined. But so every stop we would make, when we would be getting ready to get on the train, we would always figure out some sort of produce or something respectable that we could actually give to people.
The thing I loved about the stories you told about the food sharing is a sense of community that exists in the train and the people who are riding the train. And I was very struck by, when you read the book, you'll, you know, hear stories about Sergei, our producer in Moscow, and, you know, other people that you encountered who lived through the Soviet times, which I think for many of us, we think of as something that was just a terrible thing to live through. But they're nostalgic for the sense of community that living in that confined sort of political system enabled. Could you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, there's Boris is our office manager, NPR's office manager in Moscow, and he told me about a friend of his, Gia, who... He lived with Gia and Gia's family in a communal apartment in Moscow. And, you know, the reading I had done about communal living, a lot of it had focused on sort of the terrible thing it was, on families on top of each other, you know, sort of fighting over time in the kitchen, fighting over utensils, sometimes spying on each other for the government. And Boris just opened my eyes to a different side of this. It was difficult. I mean, he showed me with his fingers, you know, how the bedrooms were organized and people were literally sleeping on top of one another. But he said that the time that he spent as a kid with Gia and Gia's family was the best time in his life, because it was such a sense of community. And it wasn't just in crowded cities like Moscow. I mean, I spoke to people across the country, and when they're nostalgic for Soviet times, they feel like their village or their neighborhood you know, it just, that support network isn't there anymore. And they feel a real loss of something. And they're sort of reaching for that sense of community they once had. And it's sad. I had a lot of melancholy conversations about that.
That's what really struck me, that almost everyone you had a conversation with, or, you know, the profiles of the people that we hear about, there is, even if the system might have treated them badly, there is still a little sense of something that was lost by the Soviet system going away. And, you know, we talk about income equality a lot in this country. I mean, I think in Russia, income equality is an incredibly stark thing to look at there. And they feel, it seems to me, helpless. Is that a fair, that they feel that there's no safety net for them, that, you know, things that they might have relied on, health coverage or housing or education or all those things, they're not quite as secure now.
Yeah, helpless might be a little strong, but I think sort of reaching for something that they don't feel is in their, within their grasp right now. And I, you know, the thing that really stunned me, I had read about Soviet nostalgia, and it's something you experience when, you know, there are Communist Party rallies in the center of Moscow and you see the hammer and sickle on flags. And but I mean, I spent an afternoon with a local activist in near Lake Baikal, which is this gorgeous, stunning lake in the far east of Siberia. It's just beautiful. It makes Lake Tahoe look, you know, sort of sad. I mean, it's because it's really just stunning. And she was fighting for the environment, fighting to protect the environment. She was fighting the authorities, you know, fighting for people's rights, fighting for human rights. I mean, just, you know, really just, you know, a very vocal activist in the community. And she said she was just sad because there's this apathy right now. And she felt there used to be a greater sense of pride and community, and people were feeling very apathetic. And she said she thinks she knows what the solution might be. And she goes to her bookshelf and brings over a biography of Stalin. And I just looked at her like, I thought she was joking. She's absolutely serious. I mean, she said, we need someone who can sort of bring the order back and make people realize there's something greater that they need to fight for. And I said, so does that mean bringing back the gulags? Does that mean bringing back, I mean, death? What are we talking about? And she said, oh, no, we don't need all of that. We just need the parts of Stalin that would make life better today. And I want someone to explain to me how that's possible.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of people talk about Putin and his strengths. He's a strong man. And for a lot of people, that is a good thing. And even if they may have some sense of, you know, the country or the government isn't working for them exactly, they're not motivated enough to want to do something like take to the streets as they did in Moscow. I mean, it's a very interesting, almost sort of schizophrenic approach. But clearly for people, the symbolism of a strong leader has some resonance. Is that the sense that you got? I mean,
yeah, I mean, there is something that goes back through Russian history where there's a sense of the world is a dangerous place. And if you, as a Russian, will give yourself to the Tsar and to his mission, the Tsar will protect you and you will be protected in this dangerous world. And it's frightening the extent to which that seems to apply in the case of many Russians in 2014. I mean, you heard sort of a modern version of that from people. And, you know, and I think it, you know, I was just in Crimea for a couple weeks recently. And now the dangerous world is what's happening in eastern Ukraine. And the dangerous world is ISIS. And there's a feeling of, if this is a dangerous world, you know, I'm willing to accept whatever sacrifices I have to make if I can have, you know, an authoritative leader like Putin who will bring stability. And that's hard to hear, because, you know, we sort of have this feeling of Putin as not respecting human rights, mm-hmm. and not respecting minorities. And, you know, it's I think one of the things I really, really tried to do was to open my ears to hear sort of a sympathetic take on Putin from Russians without jumping so quickly to the, God, how can you possibly support this guy? Which I think is the instinct sometimes you can have when you're an American not familiar with Russia. And I'm a victim of that myself. I mean, I would tend to sort of jump right to that fight. But I think there's so much nuance, and Russians are sort of looking for something, and it's really important to let them sort of have their say and hear how they feel Putin fits into their lives in a way.
And I think what's interesting about that is I think I was really struck by, for many Russians, they have lived through a lot of change in the last couple of decades. I was really struck by the story of Andrei. And one of the things, and this is a young man who ran afoul of the authorities, not because he did something wrong, he was just caught up in a bad situation. And he says, we are children of perestroika, born in one country, grew up in another, and now live in a third. And I think to me that so succinctly lays out the sort of conflicting challenges that people have had to go through over the last few decades, which is why, for a sort of unnuanced look at Russia, you might think, why would people, you know, be nostalgic for a strong man, or why would Putin be popular amongst some people? But I think if you think about everything that Russia has gone through, it's a lot.
And it's tiring. I mean, the middle generation that you know, Andrei's a part of, I mean, there's a feeling of, we've been through so much upheaval. It's like, give us a break. Let the younger generation figure out what's next. And I tried to sort of hear out the younger generation, because, you know, my assumption would be that this younger generation, sort of growing up in the world of social media and interconnectedness, would, you know, they would be the ones who would start saying the things that many of us expected back at the end of the Soviet Union, like, you know, we want Western style democracy, we want those kinds of values. And, you know, there are some who certainly are saying those things, and we hear from them often, but then there are other people in that younger generation, you know, in their 20s, you know, one in a village near Chelyabinsk, which is the city where the meteorite fell, a young man.
We sent him meteorite chasing.
Yeah, I went meteorite chasing, which was awesome as a Star Wars nut. I wanted a piece of space debris. Like, that's the coolest thing. And this young man had lost both his parents. He begged the government to let him out of his mandatory military service because he was orphaned. They wouldn't do it. And he came back from a year of absolutely brutal military training saying, I was made Russian. And he was proud of it. And then, you know, Rose and I had dinner with a young man in Novosibirsk who was educated in Minnesota, you know, knows a lot about the world, travels everywhere, has a lot of money. He helps his mother run the family carpet business. This was state-owned, and she was able to grab onto it at the end of Soviet times. And so it's a very successful business. And we sat down, had a long conversation. And, you know, I said, so what do you think about Putin? And he said, he's all right. You know, he's sort of more interesting and better than some of the leaders we've had over time. And I said, well, what about the parliamentary elections? And, you know, that sounds like they were maybe rigged. And he said, you know, if there were two candidates for president and one won because of blatant rigging, I would be on the streets because the result was different. This one, you know, they padded Putin's numbers just to make sure he didn't have to do a runoff. I can live with that. I got better stuff to do than taking to the streets. And so you just, you know, Putin is, it seems like he's doing enough to keep people like that off the streets who are making money, doing okay by themselves.
Right. And that's what struck me about him. He's a fascinating character because he has a pretty good life.
Yeah.
So he doesn't want to rock the boat.
He has a YouTube video with like 8 million views of himself skiing down a ski mountain with Russian women in bikinis. I mean, he's doing fine.
That's an uplifting story in this book. I don't want everyone to think that all the stories are really sad and depressing. They're not. They're really fascinating and really insightful. And there are a lot of people trying to do right. And I love the story of the hotel where you stayed in, where the poor hotel woman, you have to register.
Yeah.
Do you want to tell that story?
Yeah, Sergey and I got to the town of Ishim in the middle of Siberia at like 10 o'clock at night, and it was an absolute blizzard. Life was insane. People were flying off the road. I mean, this is the kind of blizzard that you would expect, you know, Washington, D.C., any other city in the U.S. would basically be on lockdown, and people would have run for toilet paper and been home already. And everyone was going about their business. Like, this is normal. You know, it's 8 feet of snow on the ground. Hey, no problem. It's and so we had made a reservation at a place called the Hotel Tranquility.
Love that name.
And we arrived there in this absolute blizzard. Sergey and I are covered in snow. And when you're a foreigner in Russia, you have to register with the local authorities every time you go anywhere. And it's important for a hotel to do this. And so we got to this hotel, and Sergey asked the woman at the desk, you know, can you register my American colleague here? And she said, I have no idea how to do that, no idea what you're talking about. And Sergey said, well, I could get on Wi-Fi and look up the instructions for you. And she had no idea what Wi-Fi was. And Sergey and I were really frustrated for about 30 seconds. And then I realized how wonderful it was to be in a place that had no Wi-Fi, and that my frustration was kind of obnoxious of me to be angry at this woman who we just like trampled in on at 10 o'clock at night in a blizzard. And so she actually, Sergey went up and had this conversation with her about doing this, and came back, and we were told that the owner was going to arrive in the morning and figure this out and take care of it for us. So 6 a.m, the owner arrives, Nadezhda, with a portable photocopy machine that she had dragged through the snow from somewhere. She had found out that we were having this problem and had gone to the local migration service and spent the entire night there getting tutored on how to register foreigners, and came there in the morning, photocopied my passport. And I mean, I was so touched. And then she offers to give us a ride into the city, and she ends up being our guide in the city. This woman, it is amazing to think what she is up against. She is running her own small business in a place where bureaucrats benefit from making life as chaotic and murky as possible. Because when you're not clear about what's expected of you, when you're, you know, in business, then you can, you know, say that a business owner has done wrong and take a bribe from them, or you know, charge them a fee or a fine. And so Nadezhda was so inspiring, because what she did to go and get that training in the middle of the night is how she goes about her daily life. She tries so hard to beat the system and to call the bluff of the bureaucrats who are trying to make life murky. I mean, she actually is trying to figure out a way to avoid their idiocy and avoid the fines and, you know, fight through the murkiness and figure out a way to do the right thing. And it's those kinds of smaller battles in Russia that I think are a lot more important in the long run than you know, a big protest on the streets of the capital.
She was a really great character, and I just learned so much from all these different people that you encountered.
So did I.
I want to leave things open for questions, so I know I haven't pushed you on the hard-hitting things like, when are we going to talk about the drinking? But I'll leave that for people to read. Suffice to say, there is a lot of drinking that happens in Russia. I had the sense that there's a lot of drinking that happens in Russia, but
there's a lot of drinking that happens in Russia.
It's really amazing. Breakfast, lunch, dinner.
Whenever.
Drinking, always happening.
And it's hard to say no, because it's part of the warmth.
Yeah.
I mean, you walk in and someone will either offer you tea or vodka or cognac, and it's really, really hard to say no. Napasashuk means one for the road. And when you hear that, it's terrifying, because it means that a bottle of vodka or a bottle of homemade whiskey is going to come out, and then it's not just going to be one for the road.
Well, a lot of drinking in the book. You'll find out. So why don't we open the floor to questions? And if you could come up to the mic and state your name and your question.
My name is Angelo. When I was, we were in Russia, I think it was 2009, 2008. One thing that we heard constantly, people talking, starting with our guides, was how bad things were during the time of Yeltsin and thereafter. And I'm a physician, and I know what the figures were for healthcare and for life expectancy, which went down for everybody, mostly men, I believe was less than 60 years then. So do you think that's the reason why the person you're talking to about Putin tolerates it? Because things, according to our people we talked to, were better, much better than during those bad times.
You're saying things are better in 2008, 2009 than in Yeltsin's time?
Right. Much better.
I think that's absolutely true. I mean, if you look at sort of standard of living for people, Putin has made life better for people during his time leading Russia, post-Yeltsin. And it's a complicated story today because we hear so many headlines about, you know, how much the ruble is struggling. We hear a lot of headlines about oil prices, which Russia's economy is deeply, deeply dependent on, and that Russia's economy could be in big trouble with all of these sanctions. All of that's true. Russia's economy is unstable, to say the least. But people are certainly doing better under Vladimir Putin, and in general. And that's only part of the story because, you know, the wealth gap is enormous. And one of the fascinating things about the protests in 2011 was that the people who were protesting, largely Muscovites, well-educated, middle class, the very people who have benefited the most from Vladimir Putin were on the streets protesting against him. And so in a way, if you're Vladimir Putin and you see that, I could imagine him saying like, oh, I'm going to get through this. This is okay. Because it's actually the people who are not doing as well are not out there, you know, fighting for change. And so it's Russia's fascinating in that way. But yeah, I mean, it's there's no doubt that Putin has done good for the people of that country. When you look at some of the numbers like that, life expectancy, stunning. I mean, I think it was below 59 for a time. Then it crept up to 59. Now it's back. It's crept up over 60. And what that means is that, you know, it's a big reason why you see so many really tough babushkas on the streets of Russian towns and cities. It's a lot of women who, you know, have lost husbands and are going about it alone. And in many ways, they're the lifeblood of that generation.
We like to think in this country that Ronald Reagan had a lot to do with the wall coming down and the dissolution of the Soviet Union, but it was really Gorbachev and Glasnost and Perestroika that was really, in a large part, responsible for those changes. And I was just wondering if you had some sense of what the sort of collective conscious or the people that you ran into, what their thoughts and feelings were about that era and about Gorbachev in particular.
You know, one person comes to mind, and it was a taxi driver in the city of Krasnoyarsk. His name, Sergei. And, you know, he looked back on that moment, and it was so special for him. He called it a moment of opportunity. It was an opportunity, and it was a window for Russia to sort of find a new way. You know, he kind of believed that Gorbachev had not found the new way. He had opened the door for the new way, and that Vladimir Putin had the chance to actually figure out that new way and lock in some sort of new system and new vision, and that he hadn't done it. And he was devastated by this. He said that what we got was a KGB spy who has basically destroyed the country and sent us back to a period where we need someone else to now open the window for some sort of positive change. So I think that the people who look back at Perestroika and Gorbachev with great fondness, they feel it was lost opportunity. And it's complicated because there are some people who feel that way and don't necessarily feel like the Yeltsin democratic experiment was a good thing. I mean, the people could utter in the same sentence that what Gorbachev did was wonderful and gave this country an opportunity to figure out a new path, but that Yeltsin didn't do it the right way. They don't necessarily want Western-style democracy, but they feel like an opportunity was lost, and these are people who say that Putin has sort of mishandled something that he was given. Hi.
Hi. My name is Carolyn Poplin. I'm a physician, too. But my question is different. I mean, you were out in the remote parts of Russia where I don't suppose they see many Americans, if any. Are they curious? Are they hostile? I mean, how do they feel about the outside world? Or is where they are so remote that they just concentrate on you know, what they do every day and where they are, and don't think about the world around them.
Very, very curious. Not hostile. I would say any hostility would have been back in Moscow. You know, they're Russians who are kind of sick of these expat Americans who come in and tell them what their country should be like.
Right.
But out in the country, I mean, really, really curious. I probably got more questions than I asked from a lot of people along the way. This young man, Ivan, who I was talking about, who lost both his parents, he and his friend were sitting there, and as we were finishing the conversation, they told me that they felt like I had been brought in by this meteorite, and that this day had arrived for them to ask questions of this American because of this meteorite. I remember Ivan and his friend asked me what Rose and I were most afraid of living in Russia. And I said what I feared the most when it came to our daily lives was that you couldn't count on emergency services, you couldn't count on the police. I mean, there's a feeling in this country that if something, you know, God forbid, happened in mm-hmm. this room, we could you know, someone would help us. There was a system in place. And I didn't have that confidence, you know, in Moscow or elsewhere. Rose and I often talked about, I mean, you know, would an ambulance come? What would, and Yvonne said, so did your worst fear come true? And I said, no. I mean, we didn't ever have to call an ambulance. He's like, okay, so country's not that bad, right? and there was another young man I met in the village of Sagra. And I was saying to him, I said, you know, Vladimir Putin, you know, he's changed the Constitution to be able to run for president again. And there's a chance that he will be in power either as president or prime minister for 24 years. You know, how do you live in a system like that? And he said, how do you live in a system where so many names in politics are the same? And I said, okay, what do you mean? And we started counting and he started saying Bush, Bush, Clinton, Clinton, Bush, Bush, Obama, Obama, Clinton, Clinton. He was like, how many years is that and how many names are there? I said, okay, check. Yeah, point for Andre. But yeah, I mean, it was moments like that when it actually gave me a chance to look in the mirror myself that I found really memorable.
Thank you.
Hi, Bob Patterson. Just a quick question. You mentioned that Putin had made the perception among Russians that Putin had made life better. And certainly life has improved for a lot of people in Moscow, which has grown exponentially since 1991. Do you have a sense that the life has really gotten better for people in the regions as you traveled around, not just in Moscow, not just in some of the key provincial cities like St. Petersburg, but also throughout Russia, and that feeling is shared across the country?
So I'm not an economist, but I will say, I mean, the economic indicators suggest that people everywhere in Russia in general, you know, are better off under Putin. But it depends how you think about, you know, life getting better. I mean, there are now anti-gay laws in Russia that are some of the most horrific in the world. You know, is that life getting better? You know, the Putin regime is shutting down human rights groups, you know, nearly every day. Is that life getting better? So it's from an economic standpoint, it's I think the regions and the city, you know, you could argue that he's lifted people up across the country on average. But there are a lot of things that he's done, you know, in terms of taking away direct elections for local officials, some of the laws I just mentioned. You know, I think people could make a pretty strong case that in a lot of ways life has not gotten better in that country.
Any other questions? Sir?
Just about the wealth gap, you referred to it as big, but is it much bigger in Moscow than it is out in Siberia? And what's the wealth gap look like, or what do you see?
The wealth gap looks like you can buy a bottle of champagne for something like $37,000 at a hotel in central Moscow and travel 5 miles, and people are, you know, living in really difficult conditions. And so Moscow, I think you just feel the extremes so much more. It's interesting because there is this upper class in Moscow, and many of them are young, and they have very well-paying jobs at energy companies or law firms, and they don't have to pay rent because, you know, in many cases they've inherited flats that their parents had during Soviet times.
Right.
So they have a ton of dispensable income. And so there are these, you know, boutiques, Italian designers, I mean, lining the streets of Moscow within blocks of the Kremlin, where people can go shopping. And so you just, it's just, Moscow's the place where it just kicks you in the face.
Right.
And it's just stunning.
So does the gap exist, though, out in other words, are there sort of the local and provincial versions of oligarchs and so forth, and are there?
Absolutely, and one of them was the young man I was just talking about. I mean, that's
right,
the city
right.
of Novosibirsk, which is in the middle of Siberia, and they have local oligarchs who are running companies and doing really well. But I would say in some villages, there's no income gap because people are so impoverished. There are a lot of villages that were, you know, maybe small towns that were one industry towns, and the industry's gone. Or there are places where, you know, there was just nothing. And that's sort of what I referred to when a couple of colleagues who've written a great book about whether the Siberian curse and whether it really is a curse to actually have these communities in places where they shouldn't really exist, if you know, Russia knows what's best for it.
Thank you.
Sure, thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch on another aspect of the inequality, which is, did you see any homeless? Either in Moscow or in the countryside?
It's a good question. I would say fewer than I expected. People would be on the streets and clearly struggling. But, you know, homeless, you know, begging, you know, not as much as I expected.
Sleeping on cardboard in the snow. And
yeah, not as much as I probably would have expected. You know, and this is taking a little different direction, but the education system, the Soviet education system, was stellar and universal. And so one thing that struck me is when I would encounter people who, you know, were struggling to find food, struggling to pay the rent. You know, I remember in the village of Baikalsk, which is on Lake Baikal, there's this big debate over to shut down this polluting paper mill. And this woman, you know, just, you know, clearly didn't have much of anything, met her on the street and, you know, asked her about this mill closing. And she said, that mill needs to stay open because it's food. It's food. It's food. I need food. And Sergei, you know, was kind of describing to her what we do. And she said, who do you work for? And Sergei said, NPR, we're sort of the BBC of the United States. She had listened to the BBC. I mean, she had this, you know, wonderful sort of international attitude. So it's a country where, on average, if you sit down and have a conversation with someone, chances are they're going to know a lot more about the world than you might have expected.
Anyone else?
I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about, talking about the sort of cultural moments when people open up, when they sort of let their guard down. In that category, could you talk about the experience of the Vanyas in Russia?
I could. Thank you.
Do you just want to repeat the question?
Yeah. This is my dear friend Chandler, who's come to Russia with me and has actually been in the banya with me, has asked if I could describe the banya experience. It is something.
Firstly, what's a banya?
A banya is a Russian bathhouse, and Russians love to spend time there to heat their bodies up to absolutely uncontrollable levels that make you feel like you're not going to live another day. And then if that's not great enough, you take birch leaves, and while you're hot, you start smacking each other with birch leaves in the banya. And so this, I was in a village called Uva, in the middle of Russia, and Sergei and I didn't know if we were being followed by the FSB, which is the modern KGB, or not. I mean, this happened pretty frequently. You sort of see people following you. This wasn't rare for me in Russia. And we got to a hotel, checked in, we're walking, you know, to our rooms, and this charming guy came out and said, "Hi, I'm Vasily. Do you want to go to the banya?" And he was the only other person staying in this hotel, so I couldn't tell if he was FSB or, you know, just a charming, nice guy who wanted to hang out in the banya. So Sergey and I came up with a whole game plan. We were going to meet him in the banya, but we were going to take very specific precautions. Sergey and I were not going to both eat the same food item in case he was trying to poison and kill us. I was going to go in the banya while Sergey, you know, stayed outside and sort of watched our things. And it turned out to be this absolutely fantastic, memorable, weird night. Vasily was the president of his local banya association, and so he knew how to do it up at the banya. He was a veterinarian, and he was in town to treat some horses and cows who were having some problems. And unrelated, he brought horse sausage to go with the vodka and the beer. And we sat there for a couple hours, and then it was time to go in. Vasily explained to me the process, and he sort of heated up everything, and then started growling and getting really excited, and brought out the birch leaves. And we smacked each other with birch when our bodies were very hot all night long, and then finished up, came back out. Sergey was sitting there guarding stuff. Vasily and I decided that if he and I had been in charge, there would have been no Cold War.
Well,
I think unfortunately we're out of time. I'm sure David would be happy to answer questions during the signing. I do want to say, this is the book. We do have it up front, and because we are a community building institution, Madhulika mentioned membership. NPR is doing their membership campaign this week, so you might want to take note of that. We do appreciate membership as well. And since Rose is here and runs a fabulous restaurant on 14th Street, you might want to patronize her restaurant, and we can expand our community. But thank you so very much for coming.
Thank you for having us. Thank you.